this is Anthony Effinger. I'm the host of the Think Neuro podcast from Pacific Neuroscience Institute. I've got a great episode for you today. I am talking with Dr. Keith Heinzerling. He's the director of the treatment and research in psychedelics at PNI. And we have filmmaker Louie Schwartzberg, who is the director of Fantastic Fungi. I encourage you to see it. It is truly uplifting, especially in these challenging times. Gentlemen, I'm really excited to talk to you today. Thanks for joining us.
It's great to be here.
Thank you.
How did you two connect?
I met
Dan at Promega, which is USONA. That's where USONA, Bill Linton is the CEO of Promega, one of the largest biotech companies privately held in America. And he's also the head of USONA, or the one really spearheading the manufacturing the synthetic psilocybin. So there's, and I met Bill at Burning Man. and so, I've been a speaker there two or three times. And the last time I was there, Dan was there. And then, Dan comes up to me at the end and goes, "Oh, I really loved your presentation. I showed Fantastic Fungi there in the IMAX theater, only time I've done that." It was like, done like the day before the conference for some of the, key people, investors, whatever. People are like on Hefner. Imagine watching it on the IMAX screen.
Oh, dude. God. I got to do that.
Yeah. So the next day, we have the conference. And after I did my talk, Dan comes up to me and we're talking how much, he loves it and what can we do together.
Yeah.
And then after that, at the end of the conversation, we figure out his brother is Tim Kelly, who was the head of National Geographic. And I did Mysteries of the Unseen World. I mean, I've known Tim Kelly for 30 years, So, so also we go, "Oh my God, you're Tim's brother." And then, it's been great. So we got together in Telluride, Dan, Tim, and his other brother, at the Mushroom Festival, we showed the movie. And so we've been, reconnecting and always trying to figure out how we can brainstorm together.
So let's start with you, Dr. Heinzerling. Tell me what your background is, and then we'll get into what you're doing at TRIP.
Yes, I'm an internal medicine doctor originally, and then also board certified in addiction medicine. I spent quite a few years doing academic medicine, treating patients for drug and alcohol problems, and doing research and clinical trials to develop new treatments for addiction at UCLA. And then recently was recruited and moved over, had the pleasure of moving to Pacific Neuroscience Institute when Dr. Dan Kelly, one of the founders of Pacific Neuroscience Institute, brought me over to pursue a vision he had to work to start this program, Treatment and Research in Psychedelics, or the TRIP program, which is aimed at working to develop and realize the potential of psychedelic therapies to treat mental health, substance abuse, and other health conditions.
When did you first become interested in psychedelics as a treatment?
They're really fascinating topics. So I've always been interested in it, dating back to college. But it was when I was coming up in medical school and beginning my career in medicine, all these interesting psychedelic medications, they've been illegal. Schedule I controlled substances, the federal government put a halt on any research with them with the Controlled Substance Act in 1970, actually. So it was never something that I really thought I could realistically pursue until recently. What really got my interest again was that I went to a conference several years ago and heard one of the first lectures that Roland Griffiths, who is at Johns Hopkins, who's been one of the people leading this renaissance in research, heard Dr. Griffiths give a talk about one of their earlier psilocybin laboratory studies at Hopkins. And it really was fascinating. And I recognized pretty immediately the potential, particularly for treating drug and alcohol problems, of psychedelic therapies. But again, I went back to UCLA and we had a very, very successful and very active clinical research program going, but not using psychedelics, trying to work on standard treatments. And since most of our research was funded by the federal government, there wasn't really an opportunity to pursue that yet. But moving over to PNI, Pacific Neuroscience, I think the timing is right. Things are opening up. There's more interest and enthusiasm around this topic, the potential to raise some funds to support this research. And I was happy to make the leap and try to pursue this vision here.
What changed? I mean, we went from, you know, these things, you know, being categorized as dangerous drugs, and some of them still are, though that's changing. What's changed?
That's an excellent question. And, you know, I think a lot of things have changed. One thing is that I think it's important to remember that these psychedelic therapies, it might be new to the current generation of researchers and scientists and people, but these techniques are based on, you know, in some cases, ancient healing practices and the wisdom and knowledge of indigenous shaman and healers. And in many of those communities, these are actually very sacred and highly regarded special practices. So that knowledge has been there. And then there was quite a bit of research in the 50s, 60s, prior to the laws shutting it down, that showed that it had a lot of potential. And I think just people are coming back to it because it's really a fascinating topic and has a lot of potential. And I think in the United States, people, perhaps even due to the experience of cannabis regulations being loosened up and people seeing that, you know, yes, there can be dangers with substances, but there can be benefits. And it's hard to really make things, you know, a plant or a drug isn't by itself good or evil. It depends on how you use it, and that there are very legitimate and helpful applications of psychedelics.
What does this look like at PNI? Tell me what happens when somebody comes in to do this with you.
Yeah, excellent question. So we are focusing on working to develop the clinical infrastructure to treat patients using this psychedelic-assisted therapy model. And we have a treatment program and clinical trials. And the model, though, is the same. And people are always very reasonably interested in the medicines and the drugs, which are fascinating. But honestly, psychedelic-assisted therapy, the psychedelic trip or the drug experiences is an important part of it. But the therapy is more like a journey. It's a course of ongoing psychotherapy with one or a few psychedelic-assisted therapy sessions where a patient receives the medication under supervision of myself or another clinician here at our clinic. And those drug sessions are an important part of the therapy, but they really are the catalyst to accelerate and augment the overall psychotherapy process. And logistically, the way it works is that there's some initial counseling sessions during which the patient is prepared for this experience. And we usually set some sort of intention or treatment plan for what they want to address during the drug session. During the drug session, they come to the clinic, and I'm just going to show you really quick. We're right here in one of our, we call it our trip room. It is a room in the clinic that's set up much more like a living room than a doctor's office. There's a couch that the patients recline on that's got pillows and is comfortable. We have our blood pressure and oxygen monitor. There's a couple chairs where myself and or one of the other therapists sit, and we sit with the patient and guide the patient through the drug experience, both for their safety and also to try to help them get the max out of the experience. We've got an oxygen tank just in case, and then also a sound system. And the patient, the goal of the drug session is to assist the patient in going deep inside their mind and exploring their mind and their subconscious. So we try to create a safe container. They wear headphones through which we play, you know, relaxing meditative music, and they wear eye shades to facilitate them going deep into their subconscious. After that, there's a series of what we call integration counseling sessions where we try to bring back whatever experiences they had in their altered state back to this realm, into their normal consciousness, and try to apply that experience to try to help them with depression, anxiety, drug or alcohol problems. And we have two paths where patients can experience psychedelic assisted therapy. One is a treatment program using ketamine as the psychedelic drug. Ketamine isn't always thought of as a psychedelic, but it does have psychedelic properties. And the advantage of ketamine is it is a legal and approved drug that we can use without it being within the context of a clinical trial. And then we are working to develop clinical trials that would allow us to use what are currently still illegal medications, psilocybin, MDMA, LSD, to treat patients. And I'm proud to say our first clinical trial is very close. We're just waiting on final approval from the DEA before we can get started. But our first clinical trial is going to be psilocybin-assisted therapy for alcoholism, collaborating with Louie, incorporating Louie's visual healing nature film imagery into the psychedelic-assisted therapy process. And we hope to be up and running with that in the near future.
Do we know why psychedelics have this therapeutic properties with alcoholism and depression and these other disorders?
Well, we know that it works on two levels, the brain and the mind. And just briefly, the effects on the brain are two things that seem to be very exciting, which may be the reasons that they work, but not totally proven. But one is that the psychedelic drugs cause an increase in brain plasticity, cause the brain to secrete growth factors and literally sprout new connections, which might be why people are more open for a period of time and more flexible, more able to change. The second thing is that the psychedelic drugs seem to cause a bit of a reset of what's called the default mode network in the brain, which is kind of the resting or idling state of the brain, so that it goes more towards a normal setting, which may reduce people's obsessions or ruminations or cravings, which is seems to be mediated by that part of the brain. Then on the level of the mind, what we think happens is that during the psychedelic session, if we're lucky, we'll get what's called ego dissolution, where the boundaries between a person and the outside and everything else comes down. Their defense mechanisms come down. And by going inward, they're actually able to connect to the universe, God, a higher power, nature. Everyone uses different words depending on their background and their perspective. But connecting with something beyond ourselves really seems to be one of the biggest drivers of the therapeutic effects from the psychedelic experience. And that's why connecting with nature seems to be a very important one. And that's what led us to thinking that this collaboration with Louie, to use Louie's art to try to facilitate a greater connection with nature during the psychedelic treatment for patients, such that they then have a better response, less depression, anxiety, greater feeling of peace, and therefore less alcohol use.
Ketamine operates very differently from, say, psilocybin. Is that correct?
Yes. Ketamine is an NMDA glutamate receptor antagonist, and psilocybin and LSD work directly on the serotonin 2A receptors. Ketamine at high doses is an anesthetic, but at lower doses, it was discovered to be a rapidly acting antidepressant. And whether you use it for surgery or to treat depression or chronic pain, most doctors have considered the hallucinations or the psychedelic effects that can come from ketamine as a side effect. And they've been trying to wash that out and figure out procedures so that they can give the patient the medicine as an antidepressant solely pharmacologically and avoid the psychedelic effects. But we think that the psychedelic experience may actually be why it works as an antidepressant. And we, by trying to get rid of that, we may A, miss the point, and B, by putting ketamine back into the overall psychedelic assisted therapy model, where the emphasis isn't the pharmacology of the drug itself. The emphasis is using the drug to open the mind, to enhance what you can do in psychotherapy, that we may be able to get a better and more enduring antidepressant, anti-anxiety effect.
You know, one of the old notions about psilocybin was it was sort of a way to kind of get your brain up to full power. Is it sort of inhibiting serotonin, which is an inhibitor? Is that, am I getting that right? Or is there, are we taking our brains up to another sort of gear?
Excellent question. It's a hot topic. And Some of the researchers at Imperial College of London actually have written quite a bit about we talk about it being a higher state of consciousness. Whether we, certainly, I think just from colloquially, it would be appropriate to just, it's an altered state of consciousness, that's for sure. Whether it's higher or lower, I suppose that depends on your perspective. And they're arguing about it in terms of neurobiology, whether it should be categorized as a higher state. So, but, you know, I think it's a very intense experience. And, you know, there's a big difference, I think, also between the use of psychedelics for a person to expand their consciousness or their mind for their own personal or intellectual purposes versus the use of it in a therapeutic context. And in the therapeutic context, we're really trying to, you know, go towards oftentimes some dark and scary things, which might be underlying why the person is depressed and anxious or drinking. Whereas, you know, in the someone who's trying to explore their mind and engage the higher level of consciousness, they might go towards more of a, you know, oceanic and boundless aspect. So, you know, there are a lot of different applications, and certainly expanding your consciousness with psychedelics is an area that's of great interest. And that may be the right therapeutic experience for someone. But in a lot of cases, the therapeutic trips are not even that enjoyable. And people ask me all the time, what if I get a bad trip? But actually, that might be the most therapeutic experience. The drug knows what we're doing is surrendering and allowing the experience to unfold and allowing the drug to open the mind. And then whatever comes out. And that's then there for us to deal with in psychotherapy.
So what are the results you're seeing?
So there are quite a few clinical trials. They're early. They are relatively small numbers, but they're very well controlled and very well done. And for depression, anxiety, PTSD, drug and alcohol problems, primarily with psilocybin and MDMA. And the results are very impressive. The effect sizes, the effect is much greater than that than you typically see for antidepressants. So for example, you know, for depression, anxiety, PTSD, antidepressants with counseling might give you 25%, 30% success rate at the end of a course of therapy, 2 to 3 months. And with the psychedelic therapies, you're seeing response rates in the order of 50 to 80%, depending on the condition and what study. And another fascinating thing about it is that a lot of times when you stop an antidepressant, which just treats the symptoms, it doesn't get at the core underlying issue, it treats the symptoms. When you stop it, the condition returns, the symptoms often relapse. Whereas the fascinating thing about the psychedelic therapies is that it doesn't seem like that's happening after, you know, with one or a few psychedelic sessions accompanied by psychotherapy. Not only is the effect lasting, but in some cases it's even going up a little bit, which kind of shows you it's the experience, you know, it's a very heavy thing and very complicated. And oftentimes it may take quite a while to, you know, take such a powerful experience and figure out how to put it to good use in your life, which is why also, you know, just having a guided psychedelic trip one time may or may not be therapeutic. It may require, you know, you probably need a longstanding relationship with a therapist you trust who knows how to work with you to figure out what to do with these experiences for patients who are really suffering. Many of the patients who come to us, they've been through every treatment for depression, anxiety. You look at their history, they've taken every medication at every treatment, and they're constantly relapsing. So, you know, a single experience may not, it may have a transformative effect. That actually does happen. But even if it doesn't, there's quite a bit of potential to take that experience on an ongoing basis and, you know, chart a new course.
You talk in some of the literature from PNI about people getting unstuck or getting out of a rut. Is that what's happening here?
That's one of the things that you see clinically. And a really interesting thing, again, the brain research, when you look at either neuroimaging scans of humans' brains or research in animals, you know, and really for me, again, the thing that really got me to psychedelics was spending, you know, about 15 or 20 years trying to work with patients with drug or alcohol problems. And you know, a lot of people say, oh, they have no willpower or they're in denial. And of course that does happen sometimes, but I would see people who had been trying for years and years, trying everything under the sun, Alcoholics Anonymous, cognitive behavioral therapy, and they still were stuck in this cycle of repetitive relapses. They wanted to change, but they just could not get over the hump to change. And it seems like the psychedelics, either through the effect on brain neurotrophic factors, growth factors, and, you know, increased plasticity, or again, a reset of this resting state of the brain, it seems to like lower the threshold that's necessary to get to a new place. Like, you know, you're in this canyon going down and you want to get to the next canyon. There's cliffs, but then all of a sudden they come down and it's a nice rolling hill. You could go out, you still got to climb up the hill and go to the other side, but it's more possible.
That's fantastic. Let's bring Louie in here now and talk about how he's helping and augmenting your treatment there. Louie, thanks for joining us here.
It's great to be with you guys. Well, it's an honor to be able to work with Keith and Dan. Actually, I met Dan at a consciousness forum in Madison, where a lot of this interesting research is occurring. So I'm a filmmaker, and I just love to take people on journeys through time and scale, which I think is similar to what a psychedelic experience is. Because if you do time lapse, which is, you know, speeding up a flower blooming or slow motion of a hummingbird, I'm shifting your perception of time and scale, which in a way I think is very complementary to this, you know, psychedelic experience, which does the same thing. So I'm just thrilled that we might be able to combine this visual healing modality in conjunction with the work that, you know, Keith is doing, because I think they both go to the same place, which is what all, I think, you know, meditation practices seem to want to achieve, which is being in the moment, becoming present, you know, stopping that rumination of past or thinking about the future or thinking about your to-do list. It's hard to shut that down. I think that psychedelics does that in a very effective way. You know, that idea of being present, which for some people is scary because they've never been present, truly present. And that's what the default mode network does. I think it allows that kind of, you know, COO in the brain, the project manager in the brain, to just quiet down so that you can just be in the moment. I mean, what a rare thing to experience. So I think psychedelics are a gift that take you there. And the idea of combining it with my nature imagery, I think it has the same therapeutic effect, because if you see a flower open, it does the same thing. It's like everybody always says, oh my God, when they see my imagery. And I always kind of wonder, why do they say, oh my God? It's because oh means it made them present. The mind means it connected something deep inside of themselves. And God is that universal energy we want to be connected with. So it kind of puts you on pause and go, wow. I mean, look at the hummingbird in slow motion, or an aerial over a glacier. It's like you've never seen it. And that in and of itself makes the brain have to kind of, you know, get out of that, you know, rut mode and go, what in the heck am I even looking at? Yet it's not like, you know, trying to figure out a murder mystery. It's more like it's beautiful, which I could love to talk about. Why is it beautiful? But it enables you to become present. And I think that's the key. And one other interesting thing, Anthony, is that for me personally, you know, psychedelic experience, you know, out in the woods or wherever your power spot would be the ideal place. So because we can't do that, at least I can bring that energy into the space. And even more importantly, it isn't just a shot of the forest or here's a shot of the beach. The stuff that I do is my own journey into breaking through rhythms and patterns that touch your soul, because I'm bending time and space and I'm taking you on a journey in and of itself. You know, I'm challenging the human point of view of perception of this is normal. I mean, what does a redwood tree look at us like? And what does a mosquito look at us like? You know, one, we're scurrying around like ants if you're a 500-year-old creature. And if you're something that only lives a couple of days, we are lumbering giants. So I think all of these points of view are valid. And if I can sort of take you there, and that's what psychedelics do, because they do create that sense of oneness, that respect for all of life.
Looking now, will you, at hold it, will you put these Will people be viewing your imagery inside of the goggles or on a screen?
Yeah, so it's going to be a giant 85-inch 4K screen, which I think is the way to do it so that you can be comfortable. Also, you know, my imagery will be 4K. It's super high resolution, and it'll just enable you, I think, to relax and into it. And what's really beautiful, I plan to give the patients the power of choice. In other words, like, where's your power spot? Where do you want to, you know, go to? Is it like a forest, ocean, desert, flowers? So that you can relax into it. And this is great because this will be happening sort of at takeoff, you know, before the drug, before you feel it. So you're, you know, that way you don't have any, I know for a fact it can reduce stress and anxiety. So we're already putting you on a stress and anxiety relaxation mode. We're bringing you to the present. I'm not giving you a story you have to follow. Beauty is nature's tool for survival because we protect what we fall in love with. So beauty is the gateway into this experience because nobody taught you what's beautiful. Yet we kind of, you know, in general share the fact that we can be seduced by color, rhythm, patterns, composition. Nature does it in such an elegant way. And again, you know, because I'm manipulating time and space, I'm already like gently getting you to unwind.
Okay. What came first for you? Interest in film or interest in psychedelics, or were they concurrent?
Yeah, that's a great question. Well, in college is when I had my first psychedelic experience. So I think it just changed my worldview, you know, completely. Once you get that sense of oneness, which sounds very new agey, but it's true scientifically, you look at things differently. And I think it's affected or influenced my filmmaking, which is why I love to like break that barrier of looking at the human-centric point of view, which is, you know, normal frame rate of like 24 frames per second. In other words, normal speed. Another reason I couldn't afford film in college, but I always wanted to shoot high resolution. So I actually pioneered time-lapse cinematography. I was the first person to go out with a 35 millimeter motion picture camera and capture magic moments because I could shoot for a month or two and only use up a 4 minute roll of film, which still cost me $400, you know, for purchase and development. So I could spend a lot of time filming, but really the true reason is it filled my sense of wonder because I had no idea what the stuff was going to look like when it came back. Time-lapse clouds, flowers opening, shafts of light. I mean, you know, I sort of have an idea of what I'm doing, but until you see it, you don't know. And when you see it, that experience of being, enlightened, it's transformational. You know, again, without psychedelics, it's just totally transformational to be able to see the wonders of nature from a point of view you've never seen it before. So, I think what they kind of influence each other.
Okay. Keith, you wanted to say something there.
I was just going to say that, the preparation, one of the most important factors to facilitate a therapeutic psychedelic experience is the depth to which the patient goes, the intensity of the experience. And in the research studies, the variable that comes out as the best predictor of a therapeutic response, reduced depression or whatever, is the intensity of the experience. There's a mystical experience questionnaire. There's scales that they've, particularly the folks at Hopkins and Imperial College in London have developed and validated to measure the intensity of the psychedelic experience. And it doesn't have to be good or bad, but intense. So one of the most important factors in the preparation is to get the patient into the right frame of mind, get them to trust you and the process and the physical and emotional space to be able to truly let go and allow the experience to fully unfold, even if it might involve difficult, challenging, or even frightening emotions. And that's where Louie's artwork, I think, that's part of what we're trying to use it for. During the preparation session before the psychedelic day even, some of the patients will be viewing Louie's artwork And then, as Louie said, at the beginning of the session, once we get people into the relaxed in the right frame of mind, give them the medication. It's 30 to 60 minutes before it starts to fully kick in and they take off. Hopefully that'll be contributing to them being in the proper frame of mind to connect with nature and allow it to unfold. And then at that point, we'll allow them to, you know, go back. They can put eye shades on if they like, and then allow the rest of the experience to unfold as usual. But we think that the addition of the artwork may help patients to have a more full mystical experience from the psilocybin, and therefore more likely have a therapeutic response.
I'd just like to add too, I recently heard of a test where they gave, you know, a placebo and psychedelics to two groups. And I think what they tested was the fact that even the people who took the placebo had a higher experience than had they not taken the placebo, because they had this intention that they were going to be going to this incredible, you know, transformational experience. So the fact that, you know, the human mind itself leans into it with that expectation or intention is a factor, as is set and setting, as well as that's why, you know, bringing my imagery in, I think can help facilitate the idea that, wow, this is going to be beautiful. It's going to be relaxing. I'm already feeling at one with nature, you know, with life. That would be a very positive way to start.
A couple of things I should have asked earlier. How large of dose are we talking about in these therapeutic settings, you know, compared to say, you know, for lack of a better comparison, what people might take at a dead show? And how long are the sessions lasting? Just to give people a frame of reference.
Yeah. So, and also that's a good opportunity for me to also just mention another group that's not on the podcast today, but is been incredibly important in us being able to get this program up and running, which is the USONA Institute, which is the pharmaceutical company that is supplying the psilocybin medication to us for the study and is in clinical trials of psilocybin for depression. And they are MAPS is another psychedelic company working on MDMA. Both MAPS and USONA are quite interesting because they're not for-profit pharmaceutical companies, which sounds kind of like an oxymoron. Like, how could there be a not-for-profit pharmaceutical company? But they need to be a pharmaceutical company to take this through the FDA clinical trials to hopefully get psilocybin and MDMA FDA approved. But at the same time, they're trying to live up to the ethic and the standard and the, you know, the history and the tradition of the psychedelic community. And so we are so indebted, not only for the medication, but for the wisdom and the technical advice and expertise from everyone at USONA. So they are giving us 25 milligram capsules, psilocybin 25 milligrams, which is the standard dose that they're using in the depression trials, which is probably about equivalent to maybe 4 grams of mushrooms if you were to eat mushrooms instead of taking the capsule. It's synthetic, and there's not any evidence at the moment that it's any different than the natural psilocybin from a mushroom. And one other just interesting thing is that the researchers at Michael Bogenschutz and researchers at NYU have been working doing clinical trials of psilocybin for alcoholism. And one of the other inspirations for this study came from just me hearing them talk about their research and saying that in patients with alcoholism, there was a suggestion. I'm not sure they've determined this to be true or not yet, but a suggestion that maybe we might need a bit of a higher dose of psilocybin, higher than 25 milligrams for patients with alcoholism. But as Louie said, you know, drug set setting, those are the three variables that will influence the psychedelic experience. So the drug's only one part of it. So our approach was, well, let's stick with the 25 milligrams. We know that's safe. But if we want to augment or enhance the therapeutic psychedelic experience, let's look at the set and the setting. And, you know, allowing patients to connect more with nature due to Louie's incredible artwork, we hope will allow us to get a better therapeutic effect without increasing the psilocybin dose.
And how long are the sessions? How long can somebody expect? Yeah,
the session is typically within 5 or 6 hours, people are coming down from the psilocybin experience. But the session is a whole day thing. They arrive first thing in the morning, we check them in, get them settled. And then they have to stay in the clinic and get checked out medically to make sure that they're safe before they're driven home by someone. So it's like an 8 to 10 hour experience from soup to nuts on the day of the dosing.
Yeah, yeah. Louie, did you ever expect that we'd be living in a time when these therapies are becoming available to people the way they are?
No. No, only because, having lived through the, early 70s and the Nixon era where all this stuff was made illegal. I mean, there was LSD and magic mushrooms was never made illegal. This was just a way... as a political act for Richard Nixon to get at the people who were his enemies, people who were protesting, the anti-war movement, people of color. So, we're the war on drugs. I mean, that's the legacy we're having to overcome, which goes to show you how ridiculous it is. But, I was hoping this would have happened in 1970. There was a lot of hope and positive energy and inspiration around it. Unfortunately, because of that act, it went, underground and it was misused and abused and used recreationally to a degree that probably wasn't the right path. And so I'm actually thrilled. I drive down Ventura Boulevard in LA. I see these billboards for cannabis stores and I'm still worried if there's a cop behind me as I'm driving my vehicle. So it takes a long time to overcome paranoia. I've had it for 50 years now. And I'm grateful that it's happening. I mean, I'm so grateful because I do believe with what we're going through right now, the pandemic, the political climate of, polarization, we need to create a more compassionate, loving society. And studies have shown that in some of these trials with psychedelics, that it does create more compassion. It does create people to become more environmentally conscious, less violent in prisons. Better partners in terms of spousal relationships. I'm not saying everybody should be dosed. It's just more this is a good indicator of a benefit that society and culture needs to drift to in order for us to survive. I mean, we've got fires, pandemics, protests, violence. I mean, all of these things are indicators that we're not living in harmony with nature. And I think we need to do a major reset, as Keith said. If this is happening in the individual brain, that's great. But maybe we need a reset coming out of the pandemic. And it all seems to be in sync with what the psychedelics have to offer. And again, this was, as Keith mentioned, being used by indigenous cultures for thousands of years. And that's because they don't have that disconnection with nature, right? They don't have a disconnection with the patterns and rhythms of life, which is at maybe the root cause of the problems we're facing right now. If we all went through a rite of passage, they do at an early age, and you do this once in your life, and you realize that community connection is part of life. It's part of nature's operating instructions. Shared economies work when ecosystems flourish without greed. These kinds of values, which I think psychedelics do encourage, would be a benefit to society. It's funny. One of the most popular films now on Netflix is called, I think, Have a Good Trip. Huh. And they've got all these celebrities, Ben Stiller, talking about it's kind of not cool, the weird trips they've had, Yeah, I think, things are happening quickly. But anyways, it's a comedy documentary. And but more and more people, I think, are being honest about it, because they all want to emulate Steve Jobs. They want to Elon Musk. I mean, all these major entrepreneurs and have made a ton of money have attributed a lot of it to their psychedelic experience.
Yeah, I got to say, watching your film was one of the most uplifting experiences I've had since the pandemic started and the fires here in the West started. And the way you talked about fungi of all kinds being so fundamental and being a network, especially in, you know, in these old growth forests, I'm in Oregon here. We know a lot about that. It's really, really compelling. And the fact that these things have this effect in our brains is, it's almost like, well, boy, maybe there is a God.
Well, or maybe they're trying to tell us something. I think they're trying to tell us that we need to live in harmony with nature. You know, think about the fact that plants, sacred plants and fungi, they don't speak. They don't have language. Most life on our planet speaks chemically to one another. That's how they communicate. So how else would a mushroom speak to you? You know, I mean, and the benefits, like I said in my movie, Fantastic Fungi, you know, lion's mane for cognitive, you know, benefits, turkey tail for treating, you know, cancer.
That was incredible. You talked to your subject's main character's mother, who was cured.
Stamets' mom. Yeah.
Tell the story.
Well, Paul Stamets' mom had, you know, stage 4 breast cancer, and, you know, she was too old to be operated on, and it, you know, looked pretty bleak. And again, this could be an anomaly, but he, you know, the doctor said, well, you know, there's this weird, there's a trial going on where you take turkey tail, and then his mom goes, my son's supplying it. And so she, like, I think 4 capsules in the morning, 4 capsules in the evening. And it was at a TED Med conference. And then he walks her up on stage. And it's like, you know, I cry every time I see that moment. Now, there are, you know, you can do some research at NIH. There are studies that have been published that say the turkey tail in conjunction with traditional Western, you know, medical therapies can be very, very beneficial. Turkey tail on its own is not a cure for cancer, but in combination with other treatments, it's very beneficial. And the reality is it needs to be researched more, because the fact is big pharma is not doing that research because it's not a drug. There's no profit motive in it.
So, well, I was wondering about this when Keith was talking. You wonder about a treatment that is a one or two off, right? This is not an antidepressant that you can sell to somebody for years and years. Is that an impediment?
Yeah, it's a very big topic, and I don't frankly know the answer. I have, you know, I know what our take on it is to try to guide what we're doing, but the commercialization of this is a tricky business, because at one level, you know, realistically, you need pharmaceutical companies, you need insurance companies. If it's a treatment, you can't put your head in the sand and ignore the fact that, you know, there are professionals, and profits can drive innovation, and that's how the system works. So that's why I think it's a very exciting MAPS and USONA, I think, are trying to work within the system, but do it in a new way that at the same time puts really what probably all companies should be doing, patients ahead of profits, but at the same time recognizes that, you know, it's a company, and you have to, you know, you can't give things away totally for free all the time. But this is different. This is not developing a Zoloft or, you know, this is a different thing. And I think that we carry a huge responsibility. And, you know, Dr. Kelly and I mean, we're just a bunch of white guy doctors in Santa Monica. You know, we recognize that. We recognize where we're coming from, what our backgrounds are, what our strengths and limitations are. You know, we're trying to be as humble as possible. And respect the history and lineage, and, you know that we're standing on the shoulders of giants. But it's going to be a challenge to figure out. And if anyone has ideas, let me know, you know, how we can get these things to market so that patients can be helped, while at the same time, you know, maybe try to feed back some resources towards the indigenous communities that were responsible for this knowledge being in place in the first place, or at least, you know, us provide, you know, one of our main objectives is to try to provide these treatments in a way that is respectful of that heritage, and recognizing that we're doctors and, you know, we have medical licenses and we're in a clinic, and it's always going to be from our, you know, Western medicine perspective. We're not trying to, like, you know, take over someone else's stuff, but learn from them. But that's going to be a major challenge, how to do it. But in the end, who knows, maybe a new model of a pharmaceutical company comes out that is, you know, a better model for getting new patient, new medicines for diabetes and schizophrenia, and, you know, and so God bless MAPS and USONA for giving it a try like this. But
yeah,
it might get beaten out. There's a lot of investors, you know, there's people pouring money into for-profit companies that are working on this. And in particular, a lot of people have recognized, yeah, maybe it's one or two treatments, but there's all the other stuff, the counseling, the administrating. So a lot of people are investing in networks of clinics and, you know, that will be ready to do it. And I don't know, I'm not a business guy. Maybe that's a good idea or not. But if it was, you know, gets people more access to treatment and it's done in the right way, then, you know, that's probably a good thing in the end, I suppose.
Yeah. Yeah. I just saw there's a psilocybin company, I think from Germany, who's going public.
The Compass Pathways.
I
agree with Keith. I mean, it's hard to know how it's going to shake out, but in a way it might be, you know, following the footsteps of cannabis. I mean, first it was, you know, only approved for medical use, and then slowly, you know, became in California, you know, and, you know, Oregon, you know, recreational. I mean, in Oregon, you guys have it on the ballot right now that psilocybin is being decriminalized for therapeutic use. So it seems like we're going in that slow, methodical direction where first let's have it be approved in medical situations. In Canada, you know, they've got it, you know, this law that got passed for end of life, if you get, you know, psilocybin treatment for that. So anyways, it's happening bit by bit. But I just want to add too that, you know, this idea of bringing my visual imagery into the therapeutic, you know, psychedelic experience isn't like, you know, totally crazy, because I've already, you know, done this at UCSD at the brand new $1 billion Jacobs Medical Center in all 250 rooms, with the goal being to reduce stress, anxiety, addiction to painkillers, better sleep, shorter hospital stays. Same thing at Dallas Brain Health. So I just want to be able to just put a focus on the idea that my big mission is that I think, why isn't there a healing modality for vision? You know, we have it for touch with massage and sound therapy for hearing, aromatherapy for smell, and healthy food for taste. I'm just saying this could be a breakthrough on two levels. The idea that, you know, light energy can go through your eyes, you know, trigger the brain to generate emotions, which generates, you know, hormones going through your body, perhaps serotonin, all that good stuff in conjunction with psychedelics. I'm so excited. I'm so thrilled that we are going to be able to like actually put these two together and have it be measured, because I think either one of them is a breakthrough science.
Yeah. Well, you know, you've got some fabulous vision experts at PNI, brain and the vision. You should go hang out there a little bit more. You'll there, you will hit it off if you haven't already.
Yeah.
What they reminded me of one thing. And the first thing I heard about people using psychedelics for treatment for was end of life. People who are, you know, mortally ill, and have incurable diseases, how psychedelics are helping them cope with that. Are you going to treat any of that in your clinic?
So currently, again, basically the main determinant, we'll do psychedelic therapy for any patient with a mental health or substance use issue using whatever medication for the journey is available and seems appropriate, as long as there's not a medical contraindication. So unfortunately, the bulk of the availability is using ketamine. But yes, end of life, if a patient, so depression, anxiety, PTSD, grief, I mean, people unfortunately are losing so many family members from COVID. I expect there'll be a huge wave of complicated grief, grieving, end of life, existential crisis, drug or alcohol problems. We could use this model for any of those today in a treatment program using ketamine. And we hope to be doing clinical trials, which would give us access to psilocybin or LSD for end of life issues in the near future as well.
When will you know about the availability of those?
So at the moment, we're hoping that so right now we're in September, in case you're watching, of 2020, if you're watching this later. So we're hoping that in the next couple months, we'll get our final approval and open up recruitment for the psilocybin study to treat alcoholism. And unfortunately, it's a pretty long process getting all of the approvals and the planning. So I'm thinking over the next 6 to 12 months, we hope to roll out 2 or 3 additional studies. And grief and end of life existential crisis are at the top of the list. So perhaps in the next 12 months.
Who makes that call? Who controls the?
That's an excellent question. I mean, honestly, myself and Dr. Kelly usually sit around and dream up the stuff. And, you know, like most things, you plant a garden, right? And some of the plants grow and others end up not, right? So we plant a lot of ideas and then we take them out and bounce them off people and see which ones will grow. But if you're listening to this and you have the means, one of the biggest determinants and the reason we started with alcoholism was we had a very generous donor who was willing to make a donation to PNI to fund the study. And the person's alcoholism was near and dear to the person's heart, and it is to mine as well. So that is a big determinant. So if there's anyone out there that's interested in financially supporting, you know, our work and Louie's work, and was interested in making a donation, and their particular interest was one of these topics, that would be the determinant in the end, you know, because we need money to do these things. So if someone's going to make a donation and we've got 10 ideas and one of them is sparks their interest, we're ready to go.
Yeah. Well, I would encourage them to watch Fantastic Fungi to see the promise here and see the earth shaking stuff that's going on. Anything else?
Yeah, well, Anthony, I just want to add, like, because you asked about end of life, but in the movie, we have a great sequence, you know, from Johns Hopkins of, you know, a couple of patients that have end of life anxiety from a severe cancer diagnosis. And one of the great lines in the movie is, you know, Tony says, you know, when one of the patients who had prostate cancer, he said, you know, one of the things that happened after the session was he embraced living because he lost his fear of dying. And he's still alive and doing well. So I think that's a big benefit to the mental anguish on top of, you know, the physical problem that he's having combined. You know, imagine if you get rid of the anguish, because a lot of people, like, at end of life, I mean, why would they want it at end of life? Maybe they're scared of dying because we have these weird stories like heaven and hell and you know, am I going to, you know, evaporate into nothing? I mean, I understand why existential threats are there. But the other thing earlier on, you mentioned that, like, why is this conversation happening now? And I think that one of the cool things with Fantastic Fungi, we put it on Apple TV like 4 weeks ago. It's been number one, 4 weeks straight, number one documentary.
Wow.
And in the top 10 of all movies across all genres. So we are, you know, catalyzing a movement, I think. I think the timing of it is incredible for a number of reasons. You know, we kind of touched on a lot of them in our conversation right now. There's more of a, I think, an openness to experiences, less dogma, less propaganda from the early 70s. You did a study, I think you mentioned earlier on in college, about, you know, that period and the effects it had in the culture and the music. And we need it right now. We need it right now. And I think it's a convergence of factors that are all coming together that's allowing, you know, it's kind of like a breakdown, breakthrough scenario. There's all the, like, breakthrough drugs, breakthrough experiences, breakthrough technology. At the same time, we're dealing with things that are breaking down, like fossil fuel economies, political chaos, dysfunctional, you know, things that are occurring. That's what happened in the 70s. And we seem to be going through a similar cycle right now. And maybe that has to happen in order to, like, do it, to do the reset, to do the reboot. Some things may have to break down in order in nature for something new to be reconstituted.
Yeah, absolutely. And that is the most hopeful thing we can think. Really, thank you both for coming on here today. It's been fascinating, and I hope we get to catch up with you as the trip program rolls on and gets moving.
Thank you.
Dr. Heinzerling, Louie, thank you very much.